Have you ever noticed this thing when getting very, very close to a surface in a video game? The texture pixels are not squares, as you would expect, but they have this weird blur thing? How come? Well, thing is, the GPU doesn't really sample only the one pixel it needs for the specific screen position it is rendering at each moment, it always takes at least 4, and the color it shows us on the screen is actually the result of a weighted average of those 4 values. If we wanted to visualize what happens behind the scenes, it will look somewhat like this. I disabled the filtering for this texture, and with this code, I'm replicating the same outcome. How does it work? Let's imagine we want to calculate the color for this specific point. Without any filtering, we will get something like this. We sample all the 4 pixels surrounding it by creating 4 different samples, each one offset by 1 texel in any direction needed. Then, we calculate the gradients that go from black to white, from one pixel to another, and we use the horizontal one to first interpolate the 2 rows, then the vertical one to interpolate between those results. Wait, are you telling me that a sample is not actually a sample, but is secretly a collection of multiple fetches plus all the instructions needed for that interpolation? Yes, well, more or less. What happens is that since the GPU knows that going to grab something in memory is the slowest thing it can do, and assuming that if it needs a pixel from a texture, it will likely need many more adjacent ones anyways, for each texture read, it tries to gather as many pixels as possible until it fills the cache. In this way, it increases as much as it can the odds of already having one available at hand when rendering another section of the screen. Well, what I say is probably not 100% correct. You should ask a GFX programmer if you want to know better. That sells the idea anyways, and knowing that, what I've done in this other video doesn't seem so dumb anymore, isn't it? The reason why this whole thing is done is to have an approximation of the data that is smaller than the texel size, and think that this filtering has become so standard that modern GPUs have dedicated units that execute it directly on hardware, making the operation blazing fast. So, if everything is so standard and automatic, why bother learning how bilinear interpolation is done? Well, imagine to be doing some procedural stuff and needing some random values, such as this. Only thing is that you need something that doesn't suddenly jump from one value to another, because you're working with some vertex animation or some sort of procedural material layer painting. What do? You bilinearly interpolate the cells. Only thing is that linear interpolations might be too harsh for our applications, so can we do even better? Our brain likes wavy gradients much more, so let's make it happy. We can improve on this by simply adding a smooth step to the interpolation gradient to obtain what essentially is an easy ease. This is definitely more pleasing to look at and is much clearer what's the dominant value in each spot. Even though this is still very boxy, we basically got a blur grid. Is there a way to obtain a more organic blend? Of course there is. If we start to take in consideration more surrounding pixels for our interpolation, we can think about creating a smooth curve instead of a line to calculate our final value. This technique I'm going to talk about is not something I invented, it is the well-known bicubic interpolation, and for sure there are many smarter ways to implement it than what I did, but this was the clearest way I could find to explain the concept in an understandable manner. The idea is this. Instead of going straight from one value to another, like we're doing now, we could create a curve that passes through the first 3 points, one that passes through the second 3 points, and, as last step, interpolate those 2 curves to obtain something like this. The most common curve you can fit to 3 points is the parabola, which, in mathematical terms, is expressed like this. This just means that the value y of the curve is equal to the x you look at, multiplied and increased by other numbers a, b and c. If you change those numbers, you change the shape and position of the parabola. So, how do we find the correct values for every set of three arbitrary points? Well, we use the point coordinates inside the parabola equation and we solve a system that contains all three of them. Solving this for A, B, and C essentially means finding how to calculate their values based on the data we have available. I will spare you all of this and just show you that what comes out is this. To math people, this way of writing the result may look a bit odd, but is the form that once translated to code will use less instructions. Every time I see something like this, to me feels like magic, honestly. Let's add this to our graph with the pixels. To create the second parabola we need, we just have to duplicate the first one and change which are the points we include in the formulas. Last step to get our cubic curve is to linearly interpolate these two parabolas between each other, based on the proximity to each of these two middle points. We basically want to do a weighted average of them. And that's it! This new curve is now influenced by all four points at the same time, and it will always pass through the middle two. We're just interested in this section of the curve though. To keep the interpolation going, we just want to concatenate multiple cubic curve sections. Not bad. So, let's make a material function out of the parabola thing. And then use it to create one more material function for the cubic interpolation. So, this time we're evaluating a total of 16 values. Let's interpolate with our material function each row, and finally let's do one more interpolation vertically to get the final result. This is simply on another level. It is still possible to recognize the cells we started from, but everything is blending together much more organically, and we kind of start losing the rigid grid structure underneath at the same time. So, what do we do with that? It's up to you, get creative and share your ideas down here in the comments or in my Discord server. If you liked this video, you should really thank my patrons, their support really motivates me to keep the thing going. Moreover, I don't know if you're aware, but I have a training program there, in which I personally guide you through your own journey in the technical art. Anyways, if you want to download the interpolated noise I've built in this video, just follow the link in the description, otherwise, see you in the next one.